open it.
Please. Proof is Buck.
Man, old devil. This gonna be Buck's last day amongst the living.
What exactly he do to you?
Call it a professional robbery.
I know who you are. That love, outlaw, hunts down those who trespass against him with no mercy.
Where is he?
Where is who?
Your boss.
My boss. Clearly, you don't know me.
I heard Rufus Buck was back.
This ain't no rule to ask a friend to travel.
You think Destiny's coming to you? My guns go bang.
A new day is dawning.
Slow. This is on the head of an angel. Sins of the father, dumping the cross about to pain you. Faithful to the end. Bullets with your names, Drew. Cock back, aim, shoot, bang. I don't particularly enjoy violence. That being said, you are currently in company of extremely violent individuals.
Jump, mother. My guns go bang. I can make the guns go bang. She ain't gonna end well for you.
Really?
My name is Gil Robertson, president of the African American Film Critics Association, and today we are talking to the extraordinarily talented Jeymes Samuels about his hot new Netflix film, The Harder They Fall. We're going to kick things off by introducing you to the AAFCA members who are taking part in the conversation today, starting with our facilitator, Katia Woods in Philadelphia, Carolyn Hines in Toronto, Mercedes Springer in Atlanta, we think. Jonesy in Charlottesville, Virginia, about to be in Korea. Rhonda Rasha Penrice in Atlanta. And of course, Reginald Pounder in Chicago. I'm gonna let you guys do what you do so well, and I will see you on the other side. Oh, no, wait, and Chris Stiles, sorry, in Cleveland.
Hi, Jeymes. Great movie. Thanks so much for bringing us what you brought. I heard you once say, talk about how we think we're going to see one thing and then it switches up on us. And you did that purposely in so many different parts of the film. I particularly like the fact that you did not have a love relationship between Regina King's character and Idris. Did you think about that? How did you think about that? And why did you think about that?
Well, thank you. Good to meet you, Reggie. You know, when they show Westerns, the reason why so many people think that they don't like Westerns, right? They think they don't like Westerns. That's a common narrative I get. Is because we weren't fed the vitamins that we need in a Western. A Western is just the time and the place the movie is set. So if we took Boys in the Hood and we rewound it 100 years, that's a Western, just by default, right? But when the viewfinder that Hollywood always gave us Westerns with was always super narrow. So if you are a woman in a Western, you're always submissive to a man, or serving some kind of weak male plot. Across the board, a woman of any color. If you are a person of color in the Old West, any color, you'd be treated less than human, you'd be call the N-word 110 times in the movies, and it's a crazy thing. So what happens is the older we get, the more we want to see reflections of ourselves in these films and in these things that we seek for entertainment. So that's why we'll say we don't like Westerns, right? Because the vantage point was always like white male centric, and there's no room either side for interpretation until you actually read up about the Old West, and you find out it's actually the New West. There's all these real characters that really existed that were never portrayed. I grew up knowing all the words of Calamity Jane. I just got back from the Windy City is mighty pretty. But I never heard of Stagecoach Mary. I never heard of Gertrude Smith. I never heard of Cathay Williams. I never heard of any of these black gods that existed. So for me, I didn't want to put a love, this a convoluted way to get to my end point. I didn't want to put a love interest in there between Regina King and Idris Elba. So that's the reason Regina is repping. When that love says to her, where's your boss? She goes, my boss? She says to, Trudy Smith says to Rufus Buck, he says, you loyal to me? She says, I believe in what you're doing. And as long as that's so, ain't nothing I won't do to see it through. The operative phrase is, as long as that's so. When it ain't so, then you will meet the end of her barrel. Like the women I grew up with, at no point in time have women been subservient to men. At literally no point in time. I remember one time I got arrested and my mom came to pick me up and I thought, hey, she didn't beat me in the station. Wow, this is gonna be a good, I think we've come to a new phase in me and my mom's career. She had an umbrella with her. We were standing outside by the bus stop. And I realized, hang on a minute, it's not raining. Mommy, why have you got an umbrella? And this lady beat me from the police station to the house. Like, my mom weren't subservient to no man, nor were my sisters, nor were any girls I grew up with in the hood, and nor was any woman in history. So the fact, Reginald, that you would ask me, was that a thought that Regina doesn't have a love relationship, shows how much we've been conditioned that when we see a woman, she has to be in there because she's in love with the man. Trudy Smith is played by Regina King. She's in that movie because she's a badass. Trudy Smith is a badass. And in real life, Gertrude Smith used to run with a girl called Dolly Mickey. They were pickpockets from the Barbary Coast in San Francisco. And they used to pickpocket you. If they couldn't get what they want, they would just murder you. You weren't subservient to no man. Men were marks to those people. So I always give long-winded answers, but I just want to give you my train of thought to, you know what I mean? This town needs an enema. I never critique, I just create. I never complain, I just contribute. If no one's gonna do nothing about it, I will. But sitting back, watching us being called N-words 110 times and making a huge move, like, huh? That's where we are in civilization? Because we're black in a period piece? You have to call us nigger 100 times? You have to talk about 1 in 10,000 of us are special. And then the hero of the movie comes back. He's right about one thing. I am that 1 in 10,000. Where have we got to where we accept this stuff? And no one says nothing. Like, what has happened to us? We are gods. Like, look at what we've been through and we're all still here, right? Where is it that we have come to as a people where everyone is silent in the face of abuse on camera? Sorry guys, you just caught me on the wrong day, but I'm just saying, not on my watch.
Thank you so much.
There's a new sheriff in town. You know what I mean, Reginald?
Yes, thank you.
I'll be here all week. Let's
go. Thank you, Sheriff.
Hi, James. Mercedes here with She Critiques in Atlanta. So I heard in an interview with Regina King that she said, one of your first meetings together, you brought your guitar out and you wanted to play her some music because that's how you express your vision for the film. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about the importance of the music in this film and how you saw it visually?
Yeah, like for me, it's a really interesting thing. Because Westerns, right, are always, I grew up watching Westerns and I always like genrefy the Westerns by the music in them, right? So if you remember going back, I don't know how old you guys are, but going right back, growing up in London, there'll always be Westerns on television, right? The old school Westerns. Remember those ones, Reginald? Like the old school Bonanza and this and that. And I remember this Western series called Champion the Wonder Horse. And like the Champion the Wonder Horse, sidebar, Mr. Ed, Lassie, dogs and horses got more play in those movies than black people. It's crazy. They'll give a dog and a horse his own show but it won't give black people any play. Crazy. I digress. I would always categorize Westerns by the music behind them, right? So when you have, let's say Magnificent Seven, right? The old one with Yul Brynner, the music will be like, dun, 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 dun. Then you'll have like the Ennio Morricone, Sergio Leone, spaghetti westerns. And Sergio Leone didn't have a big budget, right? So Ennio Morricone would just take like an electric guitar and a voice. Ding, 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 ding. Instead of a big orchestra, he literally shrunk everything down and turned the whole thing on its head. But then if you look at the old TV shows like Rawhide, where Clint Eastwood actually came from, the young Clint Eastwood, be like, ride him up, get him up, Rawhide. So the music went from Mercedes. Her name was Mercedes, riding up the hill. There was that kind of music. Then it would turn into big orchestral. Then it went to like these mad, what they called the spaghetti westerns. And then later on, Clint Eastwood came back with like Unforgiven and Pale Rider. And he would do what I regard as the rainy acoustic western. It's always, stay there, but. It's always like raining in those movies, right? And you hear like, Archie. So you hear this still out of tune. You hear like. I guess I was just a man who was always lucky when it came to killing people. You'll hear like you have like the folk type joint. So for me, I was like, I want to do something wholly new. When they say that I put modern music on a Western, the music was always modern on Westerns. Billy the Kid never even heard of electricity, let alone the electric guitar. Ding, 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 ding. When you had Dean Martin and John Wayne in Rio Bravo, and Dean Martin's like, my rifle, pony, and me. The real Jesse James never heard of any music like that. That was just the modern music of the day over those, over what they called. So I didn't reimagine that old West. Hollywood did. So for me, I'm like, okay, what can we do as black people to put our stamp on this genre? And I remember when I used to listen to Barrington Levy and Dub as a kid in London. And I'll hear like, here I come. See, I used to imagine galloping. There was a guy called Pinchers who had a song, Bandolero. Hey, green girls, I'm Pasiero. I want you to wait for the bandolero. They were making cowboy music. It was just Jamaican. Let me just recreate this score. Have Regina and them riding towards the train. Bam, 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 bam. Say, liyali, liyali, liyali. Is the hardest Western music ever. All we needed is, it's almost like we're at home as black people, right? And we're seeing this Bugatti driving past by these drivers that don't know how to drive the Bugatti. This is what I call the Western. I'm like, let my people have a go at that. Let Lewis Hamilton get behind the wheel right quick. And let's see what we do sonically to while we're driving this car. Call it Old West. And that's why, like, I'll put like Regina King and Zazie Beats going in. Fine, over fella. Over, let's start what we have come into the room to do. Which for me is cowboy music. Cowboy isn't necessarily a genre of music, but it's a feel. And when you bring those things together, you have magic. And now we can watch The Hard Way 4 and it sits in its own sonic landscape, so to speak. You know what I mean?
Yes, thank you so much, James.
Thank you, Queen.
All right, James, since you brought your guitar, I feel like I need to bring mine out before I ask my
you're taking it there. Wait, one second.
Take out my electric. Hold on. You want to do a thing?
I'm still here. Someone just got like if I tune up, let's go toe to toe.
We'll go. Let's do it.
You know what I mean? Though? What have you got there? Is that electric or bass?
This is an electric. This is a PRS.
Oh, wicked.
Love it. James, I have a question for you. So you live in London and you watch these movies as a kid, and you already talked about the narrow focus, right? It's mostly filled by white men and women are subservient to them. What is it that attracted you to these films?
You know what? Like, Jonesy, man, like, say when we're watching Star Wars and stuff as kids, I love sci-fi, but we know it's make-believe, right? We know this is make-believe. I don't know one person that looks like Chewbacca, right? You know that this is make-believe. Even I do know a dude that kind of looks like Yoda, but you know that this is make-believe. But the Westerns, right? The Westerns seemed real, right? They seemed real. Like the horses, the landscape, the gunplay, it didn't seem like special effects to me, right? So I would just watch these things and take them as real. And the landscape always seemed so romantic. Like just the landscape, you know, like the way they were shot, the horizons, the vistas. You know what I'm saying, Reginald? They always seemed like mad romantic. Like, wow, man, I can imagine speaking to the love of my life. Even though I was only like 7, but a person I really like on that cliff. And there'll be things in there, like someone would have a bag of loot and there'll be snakes. When you steal the loot, it's got snakes in it and they shoot the bag. It's just things that just stick with you in the imagery. And it's really it was always a beautiful thing. But just as you get older, you start looking for yourself in what entertains you. And I just wouldn't have it. Or at least looking for my mum. Like looking for my sisters, like looking for something that I can relate to, then change. And as opposed to it pulling me away from Westerns, I just started reading about it. When I was like 13, I started reading about cowboys, Native Americans. And then I found out how much Hollywood was just lying to us. Never in the history of mankind was Native Americans galloping around like a white lady in a wagon with her children, and I'm going, ooh! It's like, stuff is just Hollywood, nonsense, right? And so when I learned, the more I learned about the real characters and stuff, the more I fell in love with the genre, because I knew what I could do with it. Like, when I get older, I'm gonna make a film. It's gonna have all of these people in it. And it's interesting, because just over the years, I would just wonder how no one's really done it before to that level. How even when you'll make a film with showing the old West and it'll have black people, the baddie would still be white, and the thing. But what about black people just in their own world, dealing with each other and just living amongst ourselves with our own goodies, our own baddies. A person that was working on the film prior, Jonesy, right? Earlier, they said, you know, James, you can't put in the train sequence. This was before the movie was with Netflix. I was like, why? It was a white person, right? Now, why can't I put in the train sequence? I mean, because, you know, they kill all those people on the train. What do you mean all those people? They kill people all the way through. And yeah, but how do they get away with killing, this white guy asked me, how do they get away with killing all those white folks on the train? I didn't even see it like that. They're baddies on the train. Those guys killed women and children. The dialogue, you read the dialogue. But how do they get away with it? Because I wrote, they get away with it. But how? With Final Draft. But how? On the computer. You turn on the computer, you write, they get away with it. Just like black people, the people have been getting away with killing our people from the beginning of time. How do they get away with it? Because someone wrote, they get away with it. And after you write, they get away with it, I put full stop in. They get away with it. And then they go on to the next scene in the story, like anyone else. Do you have beef? Then you're not the person that's meant to be working on this movie. Because in my film, like, blacks got murked, white folks got murdered, like people get murdered. It's a Western. It's a Western. What, I can't even write white folks been, if I count how many black people have been killed at the hands of white folks in movies, like I can't even count. And I made a specific effort to not make this movie about color. Those people get murked on a train to rescue their guys, and they're all bad people, no goodies. Yeah. You know, no white folks were harmed in the making of this movie, so to speak. But I don't understand. You know what I mean? Anyway.
I do. Thank you.
My pleasure, Jones. I want to hear your music as well.
I'm seeing my SoundCloud.
Yeah, for sure. I'm serious as well. I like this.
Hi, James. Carolyn Furter. Here's what happened in Carolyn Talks podcast. No, you said you fell in love with the Westerns and it's all about seeing black people on screen in the cinema. So, but I, as a black woman, I have to ask you about the controversy of casting Zazie Beetz to play Stagecoach Mary, because like, as you know, like many people, I would say myself included, questioned someone who looks like Zazie played a character like Stagecoach Mary, who in real life was a larger dark-skinned black woman. So can you just talk about that and about her casting and your reaction to people's reaction to her casting?
Fully. My reaction is, well, I'll start backwards. Firstly, peace to the Black Queen, Karen. A pleasure to meet you. My reaction is not what people think. My reaction is with glee. When everyone's like, the real Stagecoach Mary looked like this. I was like, yes, she did, Negroes. Now, when I casted Erykah Badu as Stagecoach Mary in They Die by Dawn, all you Negroes said Stagecoach Mary didn't exist. I used my own money to cast to do a Western 10 years ago, right? They Die by Dawn. With Nat Luck, the same characters, casting Michael K. Williams, Nate Parker, Giancarlo Esposito, Roger Guinevere Smith, Isaiah Washington, Harry Lennox, Joaquin Woodbine, Jesse Williams. I cast Erykah Badu as Stagecoach Mary. Not only did anyone say anything, but I'm only just beginning. Not only did anyone say, no one say nothing. They said she didn't exist. And white folks never saw They Die by Dawn. It was only black people. I've toured around black universities, this and that and the other. And they say, these people never existed. The fact, Carolyn, that people are now posting up pictures of Stagecoach Mary and all of these characters means, finally. Wait, I'm only just beginning. You will pray, and I've never said this word before, and I'm going to say it now. I've never said it before. I've just been being cool. These same people will praise Django, and you will talk about The Harder They Fall. That doesn't say the N-word once in the whole thing. You need to show me receipts. I need receipts for my black brothers and sisters of where, when Django came out, this N-word 110 times business was you were complaining about. But I haven't even finished. Wait. For this movie, it's a fictional story, right? It's a fictional story, Carolyn. The real Stagecoach Mary never met Nat Love. The real Nat Love never met Rufus Buck. Rufus Buck did not know Jim Beckwith. Jim Beckwith didn't know Bass Reeves. Bass Reeves didn't know Wiley Esco. This, that, and the other, right? None of them knew each other. It's a fictional story. And no one looks like each other. It's interesting that everyone holds on to Stagecoach Mary. The real Rufus Buck was biracial, but wait. Show me one tweet in the history of Twitter where people are complaining about Idris Elba playing Rufus Buck. I've not finished. The real Cherokee Bill was biracial. Show me one, just one, where people are complaining about Lakeith Stanfield, right? Playing Cherokee Bill. I've not finished. The real Jim Beckwith was biracial. Jim Beckwith, Cherokee Bill, Rufus Buck if you see Cherokee Bill's picture and his hair, he could pass for white. They were biracial. Now, if I made a biopic, because this isn't, what's the actress's name that made the Nina Simone movie? Zoe Saldana. And she got ripped. You're making a biopic, man. I mean, name and likeness. I wasn't making a biopic. The real Rufus Buck is biracial. And he got killed. He died at 20, I think. He was a kid. Idris Elba's many things, but he's not 20 years old. All I know, in my story, I needed Idris Elba to play to play Rufus Buck. Stagecoach Mary was not a... when you see Cherokee Bill on the screen and it makes you go... okay, but Cherokee Bill technically should have been Drake playing him. Would have been more realistic. I'm saying, see, you're laughing, Mercedes. I never made a joke about Drake. This girl's laughing. She's like, I don't want no Drake replacing Lakeith. What my point is I wasn't looking for physical likeness in the slightest. Stagecoach Mary sings in this movie. One, get that horse and a wagon. Two, get that man in the Bible. Three, get that priest in the Bible. Four, for them that's dead on a Robert. Stagecoach Mary wasn't the singer. So I casted around what I needed the particular characters to do in the film. I wasn't looking at likeness for it. I do find it interesting that everyone held on to the Stagecoach Mary thing and no one else. Because those same people would not want to replace Idris Elba for Drake. And I've got nothing, I'm not saying anything about Drake. I'm just saying that would have been more accurate. But it almost makes you laugh when you think about it. At no point in this movie is there any physical likeness. What I wanted people to do is finally, after all this time, start talking about these characters. So when I see people talk about the real Stagecoach Mary, thank you. Now, can you give her biopic, please? Now you're talking about Bass Reeves. Finally, now can you give him his biopic and stop calling us niggas 110 times in your movies? Finally, can you give Rufus Buck and the Rufus Buck gang their biopic and Cherokee Bill his biopic and all of these people their biopic? When they go, why didn't you make it realistic and show what really happened to these characters? Because then we won't be speaking about all of them at once. But because of the black god, Jeymes Samuels, speaking to the black gods, his brothers and sisters all over the world, we're all speaking about every single one of those characters. And when I bust the prequel, I'm gonna give you even more of them. I hope that answered your question, Carolyn.
No, you did. Thank you so much. And for the record, I was not here for Django Unchained. I am with you. And I am not here about the N words either.
Exactly. But you know what? And this ain't even a quick disclaimer. This ain't even a Django Unchained thing. I never speak about that movie or other movies. Like, you know, it's all good. And, you know, like, I'm just saying, for me, The Harder They Fall is the movie that we want. When people talk about black people in the Old West, I don't want to hear us be called the N-word. You know what I mean? I don't want to see our women like weakened to just, they're in there just because of love. I don't want to see, like, for me personally, I want to see, for me, my people are kings and queens. We were royal then, and we're still royal now. I want to see us in our royal form. And also, anyone could get it, no matter what the color, when I'm making a movie. Anyway, I hope that answers your question, Carolyn. And thank you for it as well, because I wanted to answer that.
Hi, I'm DJ Chris Styles, WOVU 95.9 FM out of Cleveland. Mm-hmm. How you doing?
Peace to the black gun.
Peace to you. Love your music.
Thank you, bro.
You got into it already, They Die by Dawn. I actually watched that film. This is one of the first films I've seen from you. And I've seen Harder They Fall. Like, yo, this must be a sequel to it. Can you tell me the lessons you learned on that first one, that first journey making that black Western, right? Yeah. Making this act at the time where, it's not going to work. Then 8-9 years later, is on the big stage and Hollywood said, oh yeah, it's going to work right now. Like, what's those lessons you learned on the first one?
You know what? Like, the lessons I learned on the first one, Chris, is like, one, if we're being truthful, the first lesson I learned is I'm a G. No one can tell me nothing. If I have an idea in my head, I'm executing it. From concept, I had that idea in the hood. And I told my friend, in the hood, on Harrow Road in West London, I was like, I'm making a Western. Who's in it? Everyone. How are you gonna do it, James? Watch me. And I'll just take planes to everyone's crib. Literally, I was in Erica Badu's house. She's like, how you know I could do it? Man, I know you could do this joint. That's one of the lessons. Two, you learn crazy things, Chris, like people are allergic to horses. I wouldn't even think that. Like, I'm allergic to dogs. Then I find out I'm allergic to horses. Idris is super allergic to horses. So you learn things like that. And then you learn about directing actors while horses are around. You only can do a certain amount of takes. You only think like times of the day and how, like with horses, it's a whole other, as we say in Nigeria, is a Nigerian word, wahala, means drama, trouble, right? It's a whole other wahala when you're dealing with animals, right? And then things like the desert, it just prepped me for this longer shoot. I wear contact lenses. Desert, man, like the things that get stuck in your eyes, and it's literally madness. And the amount of water you have to drink per day. So it was more that stuff. And then when it was made, I was learning about people's reactions to it. Like everyone wanted to see it, right? Everyone wanted to see it. But how uninformed, like my people were about us in that space and time. And I believe it's for particular reasons, right? I believe it's because we are taught constantly, firstly, they just erase us from that section of history as if we didn't exist. When one in four cowboys was black, the name cowboys was for black people and Mexicans. White people were called cowhands, but Hollywood just remixed everything and even took the name. So we wouldn't even think black cowboys existed. Then also we were taught, and we're still taught, that our ancestors were slaves, right? Our ancestors were slaves. They were brought to England and America and the Caribbean by slave trade. And we're taught that our ancestors were slaves. And I always tell people, nothing could be further from the truth. Our ancestors were not slaves. There was not one slave in the slave trade. Our ancestors were not slaves. They were enslaved. That's a big difference. That is a way for white folks, the media, our academics, our schooling system, to deny what they've done. We weren't slaves. Don't call my great-great-great-grandmother a slave. Your great-great-grandparents enslaved. My great-great-grandparents, they were enslaved. We weren't slaves. But when we're taught we were slaves, so you're telling me my ancestors were slaves, then I'm looking at a person that her ancestors or his ancestors enslaved my ancestors. Automatically, I'm subservient, and automatically we're trained to do what I call auto-erase. We've had to do this all our lives. Every single person who's black or a woman on this Zoom would know what I'm talking about. We, as black people, have to do auto-erase. We have to watch films and do this. To enjoy the movie, we have to do this. Auto-erase that part. We have to erase this tish as we're going, or there'll be hardly anything we could enjoy because we just get abused and insulted in every single thing we're watching. And people think that we have a chip on our shoulder or we complain a lot. We don't. We complain. You could call, I don't know, Chuck D. He's only talking about a millimeter of the things we experience on a day-to-day basis. We always have to do this thing. It's a crazy thing, Chris, because you asked me what lessons did I learn. I'm going into this long thing, but anyway, my point is I learned about allergic to horses, how to like mind time, and also about my people and how uninformed we are, including myself about who we were and our participation. Sorry for the long answer, but I'm speaking to the black god, Chris, so I have to give him a black god answer. Peace to the god.
Hey, what's up? It's Tyco here with Your Voice Media. So excited to chat with you today. First of all, no, I watched the film like twice because I never got to see black cowboys when I was younger. Like my grandma watched all these different Westerns, and it's mostly our counterparts. So to see this was pretty cool. Now, my question is this. Now, the movie was definitely action-packed and super gory-filled. Now, it kind of reminded me of, like, you know, some of those Quentin Tarantino films we kind of discussed and mentioned earlier. Mm-hmm. Now, when you presented the finished film to the film execs, were there any scenes that were hesitant to keep or asked for you to take out, or was the film perfect in their eyes with nothing to cut?
No, there's always, I mean, it's interesting because firstly, peace to the God, and a pleasure meeting you, my brother.
Pleasure meeting you, too.
There's always, you know, when you make a movie and you work with a studio, it's a collaborative process, right? So there's always things to cut and to leave in. But Netflix is like whenever any of you guys make a film, right? First, go with Netflix. Because you have like such freedom, dear my brother. Like it's a crazy thing. Your voice media, like you really get your voice at Netflix. There's an exec there, like firstly, Ted Sarandos is married to Nicole Avon, who is a black girl. That lady she's like James, a woman version. Then like Scott Stuber's down, then Tendo Magenda Tendo is like one of the black gods working at Netflix, and he's our exec. So it truly is collaborative. Like he'll have a dope idea and it's a studio where like if I didn't like a note, you know, it wouldn't make it in. But they all kind of had the same vision. But with regards to the violence, there was just one. It's interesting because there's more in that film. I removed some bits because sometimes I went,
it was a little too much.
But there was a scene where Nat Love, these guys come behind him and he pushes them to the side, Carol, and he pushes them, so I pushed them against the wall. He takes the gun out and goes, bam, and shoots two people at once through the head. And when I was watching it back, I went, I think I pushed it a little too far on that one.
I mean, is there anything that's too far? I mean, I feel there's so many other films that have pushed it too far.
If you saw, okay, watch this. The bullet went through at close range, went through the guy's eye. And went through the other guy's head. It was too far. I went a little.
What were you thinking about when you was making that scene?
How awesome it! I believe. Look, man, when you're creating, right? Mm-hmm. I have one rule. It's three words. Obey your crazy. Obey your crazy. Oh, but no matter how outlandish it is, that long shot that comes from the back of the mansion, all the way down past Rufus, right through the town, all the way up to Nat Love. Obey your crazy. And then you put everything on the table. Okay, this is a wicked meal. Maybe I put too much hot sauce in it. There was a lot of hot sauce that I had to pull a little bit back. I didn't get any hard notes from Netflix. It was all like collaborative cooking in that regard. Like it was an awesome experience, man. An awesome experience, which is why the movie came out the way it came out. And I'm not just saying, you can see with me, I'm a person, I can't hold my tongue, right?
No, but that's good.
So that's why I said we're in a good age of like videos and Zooms, and these things could be shown. Because if you print what I'm saying, when I say something like, all you Negroes, it would just read really bad. But like what I'm saying, it in jest when I refer to myself as a Negro. Sometimes I'll be speaking to one of my white friends, they'll say something like out of order. You know, they wouldn't realize because people are tone deaf to our struggle. I'm really not one of the obedient Negroes. You say that again, we'll have a serious physical disagreement. I'm
so they'll say obedient.
The green mark.
Oh no!
Like you know what I mean? We have to. But anyway, my point is, I didn't really get any notes like that. But I gave them to myself. I'm sure we should all find a way to stay in contact on this. Call like if we can all get on the same email or something, and then when I'm working on an extended cut, when I do that extended cut, I'll show you guys. I guarantee you, Carolyn.
I love an extended Chris, cut, James.
And you'll be like, except my brother with the guitar, except Jonesy. Jonesy would go, nah, James, leave it in, because we're musicians, so we're crazy. But that's the answer to that, Jake.
Thank you so much, James. And clearly all Black creatives need to go to Netflix. So
my brother, at least at first.
At first.
Yeah, man. Like you have to venture at some point. I don't think a studio would have made this movie. I think there would have been too much compromises to it. A lot of them would say they are now, but I don't know that they would have done. Not in the way that Netflix embraced it.
Hi, James. Kathy, what's Cup of Social? I am so glad you made this Western. I actually tweeted this out a year ago. I said, when are we going to get a Black Western? Because I am a fan of the Sergio Leone Westerns. I like those more than the Tom Fords, and because they were very whitewashed, and at least Sergio gave you more gritty. He gave you all the different complexes of being a cowboy, and I felt you captured that a lot. So, you know, so my thing is, like, I hope you make another Western, and I hope that you get into more of, you did, I think, a really good job of showing the adversaries between the good gang and the bad gang. So my thing is, like, if you could make, like, your own version of, like, the good and the bad and the ugly, like, how would you, who would be your three guys? You know what I mean?
That's an interesting question. If I can make my own version of the good, the bad, and the ugly, who would be the three? Probably, chances are they've all appeared in The Harder They Fall, right? I tell you who I'd make the ugly, Denzel. I'll make him the bad, right? The bad, because Lee Van Cleef was the bad. The ugly was Eli Wallach. Like, he means he's just shysty. I'll make the bad Denzel, like, have him play a proper bad, like a scary. I've never had scary Denzel before. Like, I know we had it in Training Day, but it wasn't scary to me. I was still on his side. When I watched Training Day, I didn't want him to die at the end, right? I didn't want Ethan Hawke to win. Sorry, Ethan. Denzel was, to me, is still a goodie in that movie. I mean, he's doing bad things. I'd love to see Denzel as a scary badass, like someone who we want to lose, which means you have to cast someone opposite that you can fall in love with equally, right? So the good. Maybe Idris opposite, like, because Denzel's the OG. I see Carolyn looking up like, ooh, can I see it? I don't know. maybe Idris will be the good. And who's a shiesty devil? Who's like a shiesty rascal in our, who's got, for the ugly, I need to find an actor with Kodak Black energy, right? Meaning like someone that's just saying all the wrong things, and I don't know who that is as a who will play that? Lakeith is, I mean, there's so many, I don't know. Lakeith is dope.
You would have to go new. I think you would have to go new, or maybe go theater where somebody who's really, really thing. And I would also throw in as like Coleman Domingo, if Denzel wouldn't play your bad. He would be, because he's not afraid to play dark.
But yeah, in Zola. In Zola, he's super shiesty. Coleman Domingo. He's wicked in Zola. Yeah. Samuel L. Jackson, Mercedes says. Samuel L. Not over Denzel. Maybe it's ugly. But the only thing is then you'll skew the movie like real kind of older. Whereas I want to bring it young. I think in a Western, for Black people, we'll always need like the young guy that we can, you know what I mean? The Jim Beckwith, the RJ Kyler. We'll need someone like that as just a rascal. Samuel L. would be a replacement for Denzel, but it won't be as, because Samuel L. has played bad before. It won't be as necessarily nuanced as having Denzel play an actual bad guy that we don't root for. Because I don't know someone that watched Training Day that wanted Denzel to get killed in the end. I was like, no, don't stop at the lights. You know what I mean? Like. Anyway, that's a wicked question.
Thank you so much. And
love if I do it, I'll bring you on as my exec. As one of the
execs. You got it. We'll do it.
Came from Katya.
Yeah, I was just gonna say that that scene in Equalizer 2, the snow thing, that's always a Western scene to me.
Yeah, fully. fully. Equalizer is like a cowboy, is like a Western.
Yeah, the Equalizer 2, that like water, it's not even a snow scene, it's the water scene. I was just like, this is like Western through and through.
Yeah. You know, maybe someone like, speaking of Equalizer 2, Ashton Sanders.
Oh, he's amazing.
Yeah, maybe someone like him, I'll get to play like the ugly, meaning the shiesty, right? Because you know, he's trusting. And I think when you're casting, you always have to go, call someone. Oh, someone just said Jeffrey Wright.
Yeah, but Idris and, you know, we didn't get the payoff in American Gangster.
We didn't get the payoff in American Gangster. It was too quick. Idris only in it for a little bit. I would go, like, someone that looks trusting, that is mad shiesty. So maybe like an Ashton Sanders, someone young. But, you know, he's usually quiet on screen. I'll take him louder and more braggadocious. You know what I mean? Yeah, I'll
tell you. Well, yeah, Damson Idris is good too now.
Yeah, Damson Idris is wicked. He's wicked. He's my guy as well. That's, he'll be dope.
So in talking, how, like, we haven't mentioned, but what did Jay-Z, having Jay-Z along for this ride, bring to?
It was awesome. Me and Jay have been working together for, I think, 11 years. The first track we did was a song called Shining Suit TV for Jay Electronica, when I was producing Jay Electronica's album back in the Christmas. And we've been working together since then. And while I was making They Die By Dawn, we were even cooking up ideas those days, right? Then we did The Great Gatsby together, worked on the music for The Great Gatsby. And, you know, people think that Jay was involved musically in this film, right? His involvement is musical. But there's that too, but it's really, like, Jay-Z is a cinephile. Like, if you listen to his albums from the beginning, Reasonable Doubt, they're doing Carlito's Way. References. He is deeply or profoundly steeped in cinema. So every aspect of the story will be running by myself, Jay-Z, and James Latimer, who's Will Smith's partner in Overbrook, would be cooking the story together, where I'm going in particular scenes, like in the end scene where when Nat Love walks into the mansion, and me and James Lasseter were having a debate about, like, why wouldn't he shoot him immediately? And I and James Lasseter was right. And I was like, but he can't shoot him immediately. And, like, Rufus Buck says his bars, and you know, and Jay was like, you know, when you're busting your gun, you know, it's a whole other, you know, the way Jay speaks, his voice is high, it's aspirational, kind of. You have to climb to get there. It's a whole other train of thought. So Rufus Buck would be turned around. He'd be turned around. He wouldn't have his guns on him. He'd be nursing a drink and just talking. I'm just talking to you. He'd be nursing a drink. That way Nat can't shoot. He would say, pick up your guns and turn around. That's exactly how we play the scene. So imagine, like, all of that kind of conversations throughout the creation of the movie and stuff. They're like my, it's almost like a collective brain. Or brain trust, and this, you know what I mean? The round table of the gods, and we just go back and forth in the thing. So he was really involved literally all the way from casting to script, to music, to marketing, everything. Everything is wicked.
Yeah.
Super dope.
Oh yeah, I told someone that. They were surprised. I was like, do you listen to Jay-Z's music? Like, yeah. Totally.
Yeah.
And thank you so much. This book behind me I wrote, so I really appreciate the history.
You put the book up to the camera?
Yeah.
Wicked. Black American history.
For dummies. Yeah.
I'm going to buy that joint now.
So thank you so much, because when you read these stories, they are incredible. And it's about time somebody realized all the richness that is in it and do it proper, with proper casting, proper music, proper cinematography. Amazing.
Thank you so much. I'm literally just writing down your name to get that book. I'll blast it off online. Thank you so much, Queen. And thank you, man. Like, it's nice to know that that firstly the reception for the Hard Day Fall, but also nice to know that I'm not crazy, or I am crazy, like all of my people. We are crazy. Now let us tell our own stories. Because if we don't tell our stories, we're going to be here doing auto erase till the end of time. Like, look how awesome it is, right? Look how awesome it is, Carolyn. How many people now talk about Stagecoach Mary? That's the most beautiful thing. And incidentally, I always say, like, I hate when people say woke Twitter. Literally, anytime we complain or speak about something, they marginalize us in some way, right? We're being marginalized. Woke Twitter. There's no woke Twitter. There's no such thing. It's just Black people airing our grievances, and we should all air our grievances. The way that Black women have been treated on Black people, but Black women particularly, have been treated on screen, I totally understand the question about the casting of Stagecoach Mary, because what they've been experiencing and what we've been experiencing as a people, these people say as a community, we ain't no community, we are people. And as a people, what we've been experiencing for 100 years on camera, thank you, Rhonda, for that. What we've been experiencing 100 years, and that's why these things come out. How could you cast Zaa C. Beats as Stagecoach Mary? It's sweet to me because now I'm seeing everyone talk about Stagecoach Mary. This is beautiful, but in this particular case with The Harder They Fall, that's not the case. Like, she sings, she does a bunch of things that Stagecoach Mary didn't do, which is why, and everyone is cast not according to type. But the argument is a real one. One, stop calling us woke. Like we're, call us alive. How about that? Like, we're alive. Stop calling us woke. It's not an unvalid critique because of the abuse we've been taking for 100 trillion years from every single movie that has gone before us. So it's a really beautiful thing, the amount of people that are watching The Harder They Fall and the amount of people that are talking about it and the amount of people that are speaking about Stagecoach Mary with regards to Zaa C. Beats, and the amount of people, and also these people have never heard me speak before. Like, my people ain't even heard the voice of the Black God. Hear the voice of, then you see that person, you know, when you're looking, go, man, we need a person to allow me to reintroduce myself. Like, I'm a troublemaker. I'm always in the principal's office, outside, sitting outside, always. And I always will be. So I'm here for all of us. But it is a beautiful thing, even like meeting you guys and just where this movie is taking all of us. I'm speaking to my Black queen, Kathina. She's saying that Kathy, and she's saying, like, if you could do a, we're actually here cooking up another. It's like we're here cooking up another movie. This is awesome. I've been waiting for this my whole life. When people talk about why should anyone watch The Harder They Fall? I get that question from interviewers sometimes. I always tell them, because this is the movie that shouldn't exist. This is a barbershop conversation. You know what Hollywood should do? They should make a movie with all Black people, a Western, with all Black people. And they should, and the guy cutting their hair is like, yeah, but they'll never do that. They'll never do that because, you know, Hollywood, yeah. But if they get, like, you know, there was a Rufus Buck, Stagecoach Mary, Nat Love. How can you have Rufus Buck, Stagecoach Mary, Nat Love, Cherokee Bill, Bill Pickett, Wiley Esco, Bass Reeves, who was the inspiration for The Real Lone Ranger, right? Bass Reeves, like all of these amazing people in one film. Oh, the only reason I call it The Harder They Fall is because the typo correct wouldn't spell out Black Gods. You know what I mean? Like, it's one of those ones with the hardest cast ever. So for me, it's a beautiful thing, man. I can't thank you guys. I can't thank you guys enough. If you got any more questions, I got all the time in the world.
And James, we can't thank you enough for this wonderful, wonderful movie. Thank you so much for the time. On behalf of the world's largest group of Black film critics, we appreciate you. We appreciate your talents. And I would strongly suggest to you that you leave your calendar open on March 2nd.
My brother.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you so much, my brother. And anytime you guys need me, I'm right here. You know what I mean?